In this final module, we will discuss the last major market construct that we see in the U.S. today, which is the fully integrated market construct. In a fully integrated market, the constructs we have discussed still exist, but the fully integrated market utilizes the market solutions to solve for far more of the electricity market transactions. As we talked about in earlier modules, the U.S. grid was historically dominated by vertically integrated utilities, but this began to change in the late 1990s with FERC Order 888 and Order 2000, which began to shift wholesale markets from simply bilateral markets to broader wholesale markets in order to increase competitiveness and transparency. FERC did this by encouraging, but it should be noted not mandating, all transmission-owning entities form or join a regional transmission organization, or RTO, to promote the regional administration of high-voltage transmission systems. FERC's encouragement of RTOs is important to this module because RTOs, or ISOs, independent system operators, are the entities that establish fully integrated markets and are responsible for operating them. Please note that throughout this module, we mention both RTOs and ISOs. Although there are some small differences between the two, today the difference between RTOs and ISOs is mostly semantic. So in this module, we will use the terms interchangeably. In general, the main difference between RTO and ISO is that RTOs are regulated by FERC, not by the states. This means that RTO rules are determined by a FERC-approved tariff and not by public utility commissions. And membership in an RTO by any entity is voluntary. This includes Texas, which is technically outside of FERC's jurisdiction, but all told, there are 7 RTOs in the U.S. today, and each RTO establishes its own rules and market structures, but there are many commonalities between them. Today, about 2/3 of the U.S. population is served by markets controlled by RTOs or ISOs. So what do RTOs and ISOs do? Well, they are the operators of the electricity market within their footprints and broadly perform the following functions. They manage the bulk power transmission system within their footprint. They ensure non-discriminatory access to the transmission grid by customers and suppliers. They dispatch generation assets within their footprint to keep supply and demand in balance, and they provide regional planning for generation and transmission. In many ways, RTOs perform the same function as the vertically integrated utilities they supplanted by electricity restructuring. There are, however, a number of important distinctions between RTOs and utilities. RTOs do not sell electricity to retail customers, but RTOs do purchase power from the generators, resell it to electrical distribution utilities, who then in turn resell it again to the end-use customers. RTOs may not earn profits. They're all nonprofit entities, and they don't own any physical assets. They don't own any generators, power lines, or any other equipment, and the RTOs generally cannot force generation or transmission companies to make investments. RTO decision-making is governed by a stakeholder board that consists of various electric sector constituents, and in some cases, the RTO can implement policy unilaterally without approval of the stakeholder board, but this is generally rare. All policies must, however, be approved by FERC. One important aspect of RTOs and ISOs is that they're required to remain neutral and to not take any financial or physical position in the markets they operate. They must remain neutral market makers, and although they do monitor market activity, they ensure that there is no manipulation by individual generators or groups of generators. In general, RTOs use advanced market software to decide which generator will run and at what levels, what transmission services are available and granted for the transactions to occur, and they settle and bill for all the transactions that occur within the market footprint. So how does a fully integrated market work? Basically, a fully integrated market is generation offering to generate at certain prices and load offering to purchase at certain prices, and the variances in prices being utilized to account for system constraints. At a basic level, the prices in a fully integrated market are set based on the cost of generation offered in by suppliers, and they're updated on a continual basis as the system topography changes. To set the price, most RTOs use what is known as market clearing. With this method, the RTO collects all of the offers for generation and ranks them lowest to highest. It also collects bids to provide generation to load. It then compares the offers to the bids it has received and begins to schedule the lowest cost generation to the load that has been bid in. The RTO aligns generation to load, moving up the stack of resources by cost until all of the projected load has been met. Whatever the offer of the last unit of generation needed to meet the projected load is what all of the generation that has been dispatched is paid for that specific time interval. This last unit of generation is called the marginal unit. Here is a very simple example of market clearing price using one demand bid and four offers for generation. In this example, there is 50 megawatts of demand and it has bid into the market at $15. This means that the entity that submitted this bid is willing to pay the market $15 per megawatt to serve its 50 megawatts of load. If there's generation that offers at this amount or less, it will be dispatched to serve this load. If there is not, the entity that needs to serve this 50 megawatts of load will have to self-provide the generation, utilize the real-time market, curtail the load, or find some other way to serve the load. In this example, in order to meet the demand, the entity that needs to serve this load will have to self-provide the generation, utilize the real-time market, curtail the load, or find some other way to serve the load, for example, utilizing a bilateral transaction. In this simplistic example, in order to meet this demand, the RTO starts with the lowest cost generator and continues to schedule generators based on costs until it meets all of the demand. In this case, generators 1, 2, and 3 are needed in order to meet 50 megawatts of demand. Since generator 3 is the last unit needed to meet the demand, it is the marginal unit and generators 1 and 2 will both be paid at generator 3's price. And since generator 1 and 2's marginal cost of operating are lower than generator 3's, they will clear the market and be dispatched. Generator 4 will not be dispatched. Since there is only limited transmission capacity available to serve load in the market footprint, there will inevitably be constraints that arise within the market footprint so that the lowest cost resources won't be able to serve all of the load in the market footprint. After the RTO has matched the scheduled load to the lowest cost resources, an additional study factor is then incorporated by the market operator. The RTO must then analyze the deliverability of the generation solution based on real-time transmission topography and limits. The RTO analyzes the market solution for constraints that may cause any issues, and it also looks at the economic components of the solution to ensure that they do not cause transmission flows that are counterproductive to reliable operations of the grid. The combined algorithm used to determine the optimum solution between economic and reliability is called SCED, or Security Constrained Economic Dispatch. SCED ensures reliable and economic utilization of market assets, both from a generation fleet perspective and also from a transmission grid system availability perspective. This, in theory, gives all customers the most efficient and effective use of the market assets from both an economic and reliability perspective. In order to compensate for system constraints, the market utilizes differences in pricing to encourage market participants to increase or decrease generation or load in order to alleviate the constraints. RTOs use what is known as locational marginal pricing to compensate and adjust for the transmission constraints that arise. Locational marginal prices, or LMPs, are typically made up of three components: the marginal energy component, a marginal congestion component, and a marginal loss component. RTOs may establish many LMPs across their footprints, and these LMPs are assigned to generators and loads and can be aggregated into a zonal LMP encompassing a number of generators and loads, or can be separated out into the individual loads and generators. This is known as a nodal LMP. The granularity of pricing locations vary upon each fully integrated market's implementation and the process outlined in each of the prospective business practices manuals for each of the respective markets currently in operation in the U.S. The transmission constraint, or congestion, is the component that has the most influence on the LMP. If there is no congestion across the system, the LMP would not vary significantly across the RTO footprint. If there is congestion, then there is not enough transmission capacity for all of the least cost generators to be selected, so more expensive generation must be dispatched to meet the demand. Units that otherwise wouldn't have run must be utilized. The use of market-based LMP sends price signals that reflect congestion cost to market participants, which ultimately reflects in a change to the generation being bid in at different locations on the grid. If the market functions correctly, this change in generation at the various locations across the market footprint will result in relieving the transmission congestion. In addition to energy, fully integrated markets also use the same construct to provide ancillary services, and they also utilize financial instruments in order to provide hedges against transmission costs and to create price convergence in the market. Some fully integrated markets also offer capacity as a market product. As we discussed in the Energy Imbalance Market module, the EIM utilizes SCED and locational marginal pricing to efficiently solve for the difference in scheduled and actual generation and load in real time. The fully integrated market uses this same process to efficiently serve the load within the market footprint, not only in real time, but also to efficiently dispatch generation to serve load in the day ahead. In a fully integrated market, the day-ahead market commits generation units and clears load based on projection, setting in place a plan to physically deliver generation to load within the market footprint for the following day. The day-ahead market is used to determine which generators are scheduled to operate during each hour of the following day and at what level they will need to operate based on the projected electricity demand for the following day. The day-ahead market essentially establishes the base schedule for all generation and load 24 hours in advance, and it is the best plan available to serve the projected load and obligations for the market footprint. The real-time market is what is used to account for the inevitable deviations from the scheduled generation and load in the day-ahead market to the actual generation and load as it happens. Just like the EIM, the real-time market in a fully integrated market can be considered a balancing market. The real-time market is run throughout the day in hourly and 5-minute intervals to account for the continuous difference between what was planned in the day-ahead market and what occurs in real-time. The intraday real-time solutions use different processes to ensure the reliable and economic delivery of assets to cover obligations. Differences between what was planned in the day-ahead market and what is realized in the real-time market will result in differences in the actual convergence prices between the day-ahead market and the real-time market. This results in price deviations between the two market settlement periods. Due to the increased uncertainty and changes of the real-time market can be significantly more volatile than the day-ahead market. There are countless risk management practices to identify, forecast impacts, and mitigate risk in each market participant's portfolio within the different markets and their various products. We, however, will not be touching on them in this material. But the internet has a wealth of information available if you are interested in learning more about this. Hopefully, this module has provided a very initial understanding of how a fully integrated market operates. We have only touched on some of the very basic concepts, but there is much more to learn about fully integrated markets. In reality, fully integrated markets are very complicated and have numerous other components that we did not delve into much detail here. But a quick internet search of the topics listed on this slide will provide a wealth of additional knowledge. Other aspects of markets that it might be good to have an initial grasp of are to understand some things like how the ancillary services are provided in RTOs in conjunction with their normal market energy and how financial transmission rights are utilized in market. It is very important to understand how entities are able to provide a financial hedge against the congestion charges they may be exposed to in market operations. And it's also important to understand how virtual trading can influence market pricing. Finally, some markets also offer capacity markets, so it might be good to understand how capacity markets are structured and the impacts of these markets.